One of the oldest and certainly the busiest and most famous of Liffey bridges is O'Connell Bridge. Thousands of Dubliners pass back and forth over it each day. O'Connell Bridge is unusual in that it is wider than it is long. But it is also noteworthy for a plaque commemorating Father Pat Noyes. Dubliners chuckle as they pass this plaque. Why? Well, the story begins in 1996. The Dublin City Council wanted to have something in central Dublin to mark the upcoming millennium. They settled on the idea of installing a countdown clock on O'Connell Bridge, which would project the seconds until the year 2000 onto the water of the Liffey River below. But they could never get the darn thing to work dependably. It became an embarrassment. And eventually, even before the millennium arrived, they decided to remove it. But when it was removed, it left a rectangular indentation in the west wall of the bridge. In 2004, a plaque suddenly appeared in that indentation. It was a heavy bronze plaque that fit perfectly, and it looked like it had been there for years and years. The plaque read as follows: Father Pat Noyes, advisor to Padre Clancy. He died under suspicious circumstances when his carriage plunged into the Liffey on August 10th, 1919, erected by the HSTI. Now, Dublin is brimming with plaques and monuments commemorating this or that historic figure, so no one paid much attention to one more plaque. It was there for 2 years, with no one paying it any notice, until a reporter from the Sunday Tribune got interested. He decided to investigate and write a story about it. What he found was there was no Father Noyes. And the HSTI, which supposedly erected it, that didn't exist either. No one knew who had put this heavy bronze plaque there. When the reporter published his story, it caused quite a stir in Dublin. The Dublin City Council was red-faced and voted that the plaque be removed because, and I love this language, it was not authorized. But then Dubliners got into the act and with a wink and a nod began leaving candles and flowers at this bogus plaque. 2 years after the story broke, it was revealed that two brothers had put it there as a prank. The image on the plaque is actually their father, who is very much alive. And they said the name, Father Noyes, was a play on Pater Noster, Latin for Our Father. Dubliners have had a lot of fun with this bogus plaque. The Irish musician Ian Dillon even wrote a mournful tune entitled Lament for Father Pat Noyes. Well, the plaque remains in place on O'Connell Bridge, and it is likely to stay there. It is now considered a monument to the eccentricity of the Irish. The story of how Caravaggio's The Taking of Christ ended up at the National Gallery is just amazing. Caravaggio painted it in 1602 on a commission from a wealthy Roman family. The painting depicts Judas betraying Jesus to Roman soldiers with a kiss. Caravaggio liked to put himself in his paintings. Well, why not? There he is, up in the right-hand corner, holding the lantern. There were a number of copies made of the Taking of Christ, but they were by students or followers of Caravaggio. The original, by the master himself, went missing sometime in the late 18th century and was presumed lost. For 200 years, that is pretty much the way things stood. Until in 1990, the Jesuit priests in Dublin decided to spruce up their Leeson Street residence. The superior, Father Noel Barbara, thought that as long as they were getting new carpets and drapes, they might as well give their old paintings a wee scrub too. And he called in Sergio Benedetti, a conservator at the National Gallery, for advice and help on how to clean the paintings. Benedetti was an expert on Italian painting, and he immediately became curious about a large, dark painting that hung in the priest's dining room. It was a copy of Caravaggio's The Taking of Christ. It had been given to the Jesuits in 1930 by a woman who was grateful to the priest for the comfort and solace that they had given her after her husband's death. She had bought it in Edinburgh for what would today be about $1,000 or less. When Benedetti began to remove the thick layers of varnish and soot and dirt, apparently there wasn't a lot of dusting going on, he began to see the telltale signs of Caravaggio's distinct technique and his dramatic use of light. Benedetti was convinced, but he brought in experts, Caravaggio experts from all over the world, and they too examined the painting. It was agreed, this was no copy. It was the original, which had been thought lost for 200 years. The Jesuits were flabbergasted. This painting that had hung in their dining room for 60 years with no one paying it much notice was now the subject of worldwide attention. They were told that at auction it would fetch upwards of $60 million. But Father Barber was concerned that if it were sold, it would likely leave Ireland. The Jesuits did not want that to happen. So they made a very generous gift of the painting to the National Gallery, where it is on indefinite loan. From the priest's dining room to the walls of the National Gallery, where it is a huge draw, and millions of people have come to see this priceless painting. When the British ruled Ireland, the Crown's Lord Lieutenant of Ireland lived at Dublin Castle. One of these Lord Lieutenants installed a statue of Lady Justice atop one of the gates. It was supposed to be a gift to Ireland. But there were some problems with this statue. First, she's not blindfolded. Justice is supposed to be blind. Second, when it would rain, as it often does in Ireland, one of the scales would fill up with water and it would tip in one direction. And then there's the sword. Most statues of justice have the sword down. The idea is that the law is fair and you don't need to resort to violence. But look at her. The sword is up. She's ready to go. It's like she's saying, I'm not too sure about this law thing, so I'm ready. And then, the most annoying thing, the Lord Lieutenant had Justice positioned so she's facing him in the Grand State Apartments and away from the people. Well, Dubliners were quick to pick up on this, and they would say, Lady Justice in her station with her arse to the nation. There has been a church on this site since 1028. It is Anglican today, but at other times, most times, during its long history, it was a Catholic church. And that is why the Catholic Cathedral in Dublin was given the name St. Mary's Pro Cathedral, pro meaning temporary or provisional. The Vatican believes that Christ Church should someday be restored to its prior status as Dublin's Catholic Cathedral. Christ Church has a long and storied musical history. There has been an organist employed here without interruption since 1595. It was in Dublin, in 1742, that Handel's Messiah was performed for the very first time. And when the world first heard that now famous Hallelujah chorus, it was Christ Church Cathedral's choir that sang it. The crypt under the cathedral dates back to the 1200s. It contains various monuments and historic features, but none more surprising or unexpected than the mummified remains of a cat and a rat. The story goes that the two must have gotten trapped in a pipe of the Christ Church organ. There is a sign nearby that reads as follows. The cat and the rat, the one presumably chasing the other, became trapped in an organ pipe in the 1850s and were mummified. These two very unlucky animals were immortalized by James Joyce in his novel Finnegan's Wake, where Joyce had one character say to the other, "Oh, you're stuck. You're as stuck as that cat to that mouse in that tube of the Christ Church organ." And that would be pretty stuck. Not far from Christ Church Cathedral, just a short walk away, is another cathedral. St. Patrick's, which is also Anglican. It dates back to 1191, and it is the largest church in all of Ireland. It is outrageous, but when Cromwell was in Ireland, he stabled his horses in the nave of this beautiful cathedral. It was his way of showing his disrespect for the Anglican religion, which to his mind was too much like Catholicism. The most famous person associated with St. Patrick's is Jonathan Swift, who was dean here from 1713 until his death in 1745. Swift wrote Gulliver's Travels and a famous satirical essay, A Modest Proposal. He is considered by many to be the foremost writer of satire in the English language. Swift was, well, a thorn in the side to many. He had a knack for saying things that people didn't like to hear, both the Irish and the British. But in his own way, he loved his fellow Irish. He fought hard against what he felt were unjust impositions by the British on the Irish people. And when he died, he left his entire fortune to found a hospital to care for the mentally ill. In that regard, he was ahead of his time. But lest anyone think that he had become an old softy in his old age, or that he had lost any of his cutting wit, he wrote that he was leaving money in his will to establish a hospital in Ireland for idiots and lunatics because no nation needed it so much. Well, Ireland got the hospital anyway, and it's still in operation today. Swift is buried here in the cathedral. Before he died, he wrote his own epitaph and left instructions that it be carved on black Kilkenny marble and mounted on the rear wall of the cathedral. And so it was. You know that lion who roars at the beginning of MGM movies, who we have all seen? You probably think that lion comes from Africa. But no, he was a dub. That's right, a dub. He was born and raised at the Dublin Zoo. Founded in 1830, the Dublin Zoo is the third oldest zoo in the world. But how the heck did this Dublin lion end up in Hollywood? Well, in 1923, Goldwyn Studios, which would soon become MGM, summoned Volney Pfeiffer, the top animal trainer in Hollywood, to their studio lot. They charged Pfeiffer with the task of traveling to Africa and bringing back a lion which MGM could use at the opening of their movies. So Pfeiffer, who knew his way around lions, set out for Africa. But first, he stopped off in Dublin for a few days. The story goes that while in a Dublin pub enjoying a pint, he struck up a conversation with the bartender and mentioned to him that he was on his way to Africa to get a lion. The bartender looked at him and said, "And why would you do that? Why would you be traipsing off to Africa when we have grand lions for you right here in Dublin?" Pfeiffer said, "Really?" And the bartender said, "Yes, surely to God we do. Yes, we do. Sure, this is it." Pfeiffer thought, "What an old blather." But it turned out the bartender was absolutely correct. The Dublin Zoo had remarkable success breeding healthy lions. Between 1857 and 1962, the zoo produced an astounding 565 lion cubs from 181 litters. For many years, the Dublin Zoo was the go-to place in the world for circuses and other zoos to get their lion cubs. The zoo's lions would sometimes enjoy a meal of boiled potatoes and medicinal doses of whiskey punch, which apparently did them no harm at all. There was one memorable birth in 1899, where, for whatever reason, the mother rejected her three little cubs. But an Irish setter stepped in and saved the day. She said, "No problem, I'll nurse these wee cubs meself." So Volney Pfeiffer never made it to Africa. Instead, he went to the Dublin Zoo and got MGM's lion there. The lion, who was called Carebray, a Gaelic name, was about 4 years old when he and Pfeiffer set out for Hollywood. With MGM picking up the tab, the sky was the limit, and Pfeiffer and Carebray had a ball traveling in grand style, first by ship to New York, and then by train onto sunny California. When Carebray finally landed in Hollywood, the very first thing MGM did was to change his name to Slats, which reportedly did not please him one bit. But like so many Hollywood stars of the day, he had to put up with it. Pfeiffer trained Slats, and a strong lifelong bond developed between the two. Slats made his very first appearance in the opening credits of the 1924 MGM film He Who Gets Slapped with Lon Chaney and Norma Shearer. Now, the question everyone asks is, did Slats roar with an Irish brogue? Well, the answer is, we don't know. All the films were silent then. Slats didn't roar. As you can see here, he just kind of looks around. Let's see that again. He looks a little confused, as if he was wondering, what the heck am I doing here? But you know, if you were living very nicely at the Dublin Zoo, and then you find yourself in Hollywood with the lights and the camera and everyone calling you Slats, you would be confused, wouldn't you? You would, surely. Slats appeared at the opening of every MGM film from 1924 until 1928. He died in 1936 and was buried on his train of Volney Pfeiffer's farm in Gillette, New Jersey. Good on you, Slats, a dub who made good in Hollywood. With any luck, you're up in heaven now enjoying a big feed of boiled potatoes and whiskey punch.